Our speaker today is Lionel Davis. He used to be a member of this Family History Society, but I'm not going to say anything more about him. He's a very distinguished man. I'm going to ask Cherie Wright to introduce him. I know Cherie's a school teacher, so she won't want this.
About a year ago, Sandra, who works at the front desk welcoming people, gave me this piece of paper from the newspaper from the weekend Argus, because quite often people give me suggestions about who we should get to speak. And having a look at the photographs and the amazing artwork, I suddenly realized that this chap who we were talking about, Lionel Davis, was an esteemed artist, and yet somebody I'd seen fairly frequently popping in at meetings at Cape Town Family History Society. And Sandra scribbled on the front his details so that I could get hold of him. And I think I might have sent him an email at the time, but I was a bit reticent phoning. And eventually, a few weeks later, I happened to be at a lunch in Cork Bay where Lionel was one of the guests too. And I took the opportunity there, and he said, well, he'd really love to come and talk about his life, but he had this huge exhibition which was going to happen in June of this year. So if I didn't mind, can we make it after the exhibition? What amazed me most, I think, was the colorful and quite incredible life Lionel has had up until now. Surprised also to know that he celebrated his 81st birthday. I'm sorry, Lionel. In June, as this exhibition happened. It's still on at the National Gallery. We don't have examples of his artwork, but I urge everybody to go and pop in and have a look at this retrospective of his life's work, really, at the National Gallery in Cape Town. I'm not going to presume to know all about Lionel's life, because he's here to talk about the way the Cape Town, the Southeastern, has blown him over time. So, with no further ado, Lionel Davis.
The title of my exhibition is Gathering Strands. I've had many strands that have made up my life. I'm an artist, but I am not a career artist. I do not make art for a living. I talk for a living. You can make art every day, but you cannot sell art every day. It's a tough job. And I've always looked for the easy way out. So I talk for a living. I talk, I get paid, I make art. I'm not sure whether I'm going to sell a damn piece or not. So talking is much easier for me. As I said, I have many strands to my life. I am also a former Robben Island political prisoner. I was in jail for 7 years. And worse than being in jail, I was under house arrest for 5 years. That is the most traumatic experience for those who know. Most people who are placed on the house list leave the country. And in those days, you were not allowed to come back. 60s, 70s, 80s, you left the country, not allowed to come back. Even if your dears died in South Africa, you were not allowed to come back. You break your banning order, all the black marks add up, and eventually shove you back in jail. So that was my experience. Fortunately, post my house arrest, I went to an art center called the Community Arts Project. Some of you, the older generation, will know CAP. And that's when my healing started. It was my first formal art education at the age of 41. I continued making art, and eventually even went to university at the age of 54 to study at UCT. So I'm a late starter, rather a late beginner. But today I want to talk about some of my experiences. I could have But I come from a South Africa that was very divided. It is still a very divided South Africa. And all those spatial plannings from the Apartheid era still exist today, sadly. I was living in District 6, that's where I was born in 1936. And of course, we then still had a mixed community. Most of the whites that had settled there, starting in the 1800s, eventually left District 6 because whites were always favored, economically favored, opportunity favored. I'm talking about pre-apartheid and during the apartheid era. They were favored. Their economic position circumstance changed, and because of economic opportunity, they could move from District 6. But they still owned properties, shops, businesses in District 6. As a child, those are the days when we did not have fridges, or what you call it, cold storage facilities, cold as boxes. And you ate, you bought today, you ate today. And as a child, it was my duty to help the family. I had to go to, I had to do shopping for them. Small items that I had to buy. And one day, I think it was on a Saturday, I went to the shops. Now, there were two main arteries where the shops were. One was Hanover Street, the other was Cannington Street. I went to the shop. Those were the days when there were no TV, of course. Entertainment, you may know the entertainment. And the street was our TV show. Everything happened in the street. All sorts of people gathered in the street. And on this particular day, the shopkeeper was standing at the edge of the pavement. I am not aware of social courtesies, I'm not aware of these things. I passed by him. He's got his back to go into his shop. When he turns around and he sees his little black boy standing there, the first thing that came into his mind is that I have come to steal. That's why I sneaked in. I had the little bag with me. And he wanted to know what was in the bag. I had come to buy half a dozen eggs. He eventually served me, but insisted he wanted to look into the bag. Eventually got hold of the bag, and I let him have the bag, yes. I had bought half a dozen of eggs, and grabbed the bag, nothing in it, he just shrugged his shoulders. No apology, and that infuriated me. I'm 13 years of age. I got so mad, I grabbed one of the eggs, I launched it at his head. My regret is I missed, and I had to run. When I look back at my life and my involvement with political organizations, I can look at on that particular event that catapulted me into wanting to go to political gathering. Because as I grew older, I had confrontations with everything that was white. Those were the days of job apartheid. Your train drivers, your bus conductors, they were all white. You could not miss seeing or having contact with white authority. And wherever I went, I had this confrontation because I was forever standing up for fellow black workers and people that I didn't even know were being abused by white authority. And that is what made me go to political meetings. And that is what made me join a political organization. And eventually, I joined an organization called the National Liberation Front, with Neville Alexander and others. And our intention was to take up arms, very much like the Pan-African Congress, the African National Congress, to fight for what we believe was our right. A society that we equal, not racist. Unfortunately, we did not get very far because we were arrested and sent to jail. We were 11, four women, seven men. Four women sent to another jail, and the seven went to Robben Island, seven men. And I had the good fortune that that is where I met some brilliant minds, some wonderful human beings who were prepared to die for what they believed in. And one of them was Nelson Mandela. And for those who have been to Robben Island, you know that the jail was divided into different sections. I spent most of that, my 7 years in that section where Mandela was. And a lot of my learning started there. When we look at Robben Island, we think of all the grimness, the sadness, the abuse that went on there. But one of the things, ironically, is that that is where we actually learned to live together, like South Africans should be living together today. Whether you were a peasant, whether you were a lawyer, we were one. That is where we learned to stand together to fight for our rights as prisoners, regardless of our political affiliations. Most people think that Robben Island was the enclave or the ANC had the authority there. No. We came from many different political persuasions. But the one thing that we learned there is that if we want to survive the ordeals of Robben Island, we had to learn to live together, stand together, regardless of our political differences. And that endured for the 7 years of my stay on Robben Island. Because we went on hunger strikes together to fight for better food, better clothing, to fight the discriminatory practices of giving Asiatics and those classified colored better food and better clothing than our other black brothers. That is where we eventually learned to play sport together. There is a film that I hope you see one day. It's titled More Than Just a Game. You may have seen it on TV also, which shows how prisoners from very different political backgrounds, cultural backgrounds, played soccer together. It's a remarkable film. It will give you some idea of how we enhance the quality of our own lives regardless of the difficulties that we faced. You will also learn that, if you read about it, you will learn about how prisoners who came there with limited education left Robben Island with university degrees, studied through the University of South Africa. Remarkable achievements. I myself, I got my education on Robben Island. My educators came from very different strands of life. Different cultures, spoke different languages, belonged to different political persuasions. And they, some of these guys, when they came, they were lawyers, they were medical doctors, they were high school teachers, graduates, and they gave unselfishly. And they helped to build that unity that we required. Because without that unity, we would have all been destroyed on Robben Island. Not even Nelson Mandela would have left jail whole, mentally, physically. With the help of our own people in South Africa, black and white, with the help of the United Nations, Amnesty International, and the International Red Cross, Helen Suzman, whoever knows Helen Suzman, she was a parliamentarian in the 60s, in all-white parliament, she was the only woman who made an effort to come to Robben Island to find out what our grievances were. I would also like you to note that there were also white comrades who went to jail, who were sentenced to life. I know of two who went to the gallows who were hung because of their political involvement. So, it was a fight for justice, for equality. When Mandela was released from jail in 1990, He called it all South Africans. That we cannot build a new South Africa with bitterness and hatred. We needed to build a society where each one would be given opportunity to become the best that he or she could become. Now, Mandela's dream has not been fulfilled. We were all so enthusiastic to go to travel together, to travel together in this new South Africa that Mandela was talking about. It has not yet been realized. And all that he had begun has not yet been fulfilled. Today we are as divided as ever. And I would like you to think about that. How do you change society? We may not have political power as individuals, but if each one of us could make an effort to become the dream that Mandela is talking about, to become the change that we would want to see in this country, it would be a good step forward. We can help to make this a better country to live in. I was born into a colored community, a divided community. When I was arrested in 1963, it was in District 6. Released from jail, people living in District 6 had all been removed. 1966, District 6 was declared white. And all people of color were forcefully removed, tracked out. No say, you just have to accept. We are still living in those colored divided boxes. You go to Manhattan, because that is where I lived after my jail experience. 5 years I lived in Manhattan under house arrest. You go to Manhattan, it's even worse than what it was when I was in East Mountain. I was thrust back into a color box. There is a lot that has to be done to change this country, to make it a better place to live in, for our children, for our grandchildren, for the future of this country. But as I said, it begins with you. You must be that change that you want to see in the society. We can all stand and raise and say, government this, government that, yes, they're not doing a good job. But what is each one of us doing to help to bring about the change? That is the question that we must ask ourselves. My family was born, raised on the Falsman coast. My great-grandfather was a crewman from Sierra Leone. My mother was born in Simonstown. And she is of Khoisan slave and Dutch descent. We must look at ourselves and be proud of who we are, regardless of whether you see yourself as white, as black, or whatever it's colored. We have the same origins. And if we can accept that we are children of God, the creations of God, that we, each one of us is equal to the other, then we will be on our way to build a new South Africa, a better South Africa. Thank you.
Thank you, Lionel. From the rapt attention everybody paid, obviously you had a powerful message which you delivered in an exceptional manner. I don't know if you'd like to take a few questions. Are you happy to take some questions?
I don't mind.
Would anybody like to ask?
You mentioned you are descended from a crewman.
Yeah.
Great grandfather. Can you tell us anything about the crewman? Because there doesn't seem to be a lot.
There have been articles written by individual people, researchers. What I do know is that they were, if you look at Sierra Leone, You had the indigenous people, that I believe they were also called the crew. And then you had those who actually worked for the British naval forces on the boats traveling the world, because Britain was then the naval force. Today, of course, it's the Americans, it's the Chinese, it's the Russians, but those days it was the British. And many are because the crew was such people from Sierra Leone, from Liberia, were excellent oarsmen. They joined the merchant ships, and they went to wherever they were, British colonies. And many of them actually landed up in Simon Stout, got married to the local people. Then also, when the ships could not get to West Africa, many of them were landed off at St. Helena Island, because that was British. And again, you had intermingling, intermarriage between the people that were at St. Helena and the Sierra Leoneans, Liberians. They had to wait for months before they could get back to West Africa. And if you think of St. Helena, think of the Zulus, princes, Zulu royalty, who were fighting against the British, who, like Napoleon and others, were also banished, like those from the Anglo-Boer War, who were banished to St. Helena Island. So people talk about St. Helena, you know, with pride, yes, but they just want to look at St. Helena as this entity that is not mixed. We are mixed. St. Helenians are mixed. And we do not run away from who we are. We must accept that we are God's children. They say you're not a Christian, and you doubt the work of God. What does it say about you? So yes, some of my relatives also landed up at St. Helena or West Africa. But my great-grandfather landed up in Simon Stout. He's Davis. My surname is Davis. But that is just another slave name. You would have to trace my name, because when they got onto the boats and the white crew, those in charge, the captains, could not pronounce your surname, your African surname, they gave you the surname. These are the things that we must look at. Because my surname is a slave name. Not my original grandfather's surname. So I do, that's a little bit about St. Helena. I mean St. Helena about the crew. There are many people living in Ocean View. Who originally from Simon Stout, who are of Crewman descent. And I'm proud. I'm a mixture of everything. The Khoisan runs through my veins. West Africa runs through my veins. Europe runs through my veins. Malaysia runs through my veins. But I am a proud human being. Africa is my beginning. Africa is my end. Thank you.
Any more questions? On behalf of the society, we're not going to give you a great big wad of money for speaking to us.
Jesus, I was disappointed. I thought I was getting a bag of gold from you.
But yes, sir. Sorry.
Earlier, we saw some paintings up on the screen. Could you explain your art to us?
I don't know that that was my art.
Isn't that your
art? No, I don't think so. No.
Say something like that, and also
What is in the Sandstone Museum? I think Sir Peter Clark, your colleague, is an artist, but he also traced his origins back to the crewmen.
That's right. His mother is of crewmen descent, and my granduncles and aunts went to school with Peter's mother in Simonstown. Also, Peter and I used to visit the Simonstown Museum. I once showed me a photograph of members of the, I think they call it the Kilmarnock Lodge. Now, it was a time when people from the coloured communities used to join these lodges. It's like supposed to be secret associations with a very Christian orientation. And they call it lodges. And they used to wear these sashes that said that they were members of this particular society. And there was this photograph that had Peter's grandfather on there as a member. And there was a grand uncle of mine. And Peter showed me my grand uncle. I think it was his name, I think it was Patrick or something. Yeah. So that association is there. And they eventually, of course, with the group in this act, they were also forced out. And from my mother's side, they were Kessners, lived in Sunny Day in Lotichia, in those many, many years ago. They were all forced to go to Ocean View. Yeah. Thank you so much for that, yeah. And the book, yes, in September, a book will be published with, there are 11 people writing essays about me. Some are academic and some are not academic, writing about me. They will also, I am also a writer, belong to a memoir writing group. There will be an article by me, an essay by me, and then also the writings will be accompanied by my own artwork, complementing the writing. And that will be out in September, mid-September, just to inform you. But my exhibition is on, it's titled Gallery of Strands, on at the South African National Gallery, and will be there until the end of September, beginning of October. Thank you so much. Any other questions? Yes, there's a... Yeah, yeah. The lady there, right in the middle there.
Yes, I'd like to know...
Let us see you, who you are, darling. I can't hear you. Your age is against me.
So, we've been talking about strands of experience and strands of contributing to you. And I'd be interested to know how... your experiences in the past and your historical, you know, what has affected you, how that has impacted on your art?
Well, look, one of the things that I am glad for, I have, in a sense, been liberated. You know, there was a time when, during the political struggle, 70s, 80s, if you painted flowers or you spoke about your dreams, somebody would say there's no time for dreams. You must use your art to make political statements. And I know friends of mine who had this mindset, no time for dreams. For me, there has always been time for dreams. And post 1994, I now have that freedom. And if I want to make a political statement, if I want to say something that does not agree with me, that I find is wrong, and I want to make an art piece, I shall do so. I have earned that right to express myself in whichever way I feel fit. As long as I respect people, individuals. And I don't only make figurative statements, I'm also an abstract artist. Go see my exhibition and you will get to know me better.
Now, there may be more people such as I who have stories to tell. And maybe be able to do that and forward it to you so that you can perhaps include it in the work that you said you're going to do.
Am I talking to Ursula?
Yes.
Good. Thank you. Now, I do know you, Ursula, and I know about your contribution to our struggle for change. And I salute you, my sister. Any other questions?
I'm Muhammad Kamani from the Other Feministy Society, in terms of slavery roots. I'm just fascinated by the statement you made that while you were on the island, it was a micro reflection of the bigger South Africa that is in conflict, driven and driven over centuries. But all of you are able to transcend it coming from different political persuasions. Now, what was the recipe that you were all able to transcend it and kind of create this embryonic South Africa that you envisioned all on the island before you slipped off the island? So my question is, the coping skills, what actually, how everyone had to adjust to live together in a confined space like that, but most important, transcending or just listening or stepping back from their own political positions. Because as you say, now that we stepped off the island, we were confronted with still with the same South African issues. And also another issue that I find fascinating, your connection with Robben Island as your Alcatraz, and then your family roots also via St. Helena, where St. Helena was also Napoleon's Alcatraz. Mm-hmm. And what I see in terms of Robben Island, I think I've mentioned it here previously, somehow the whole of South Africa ended up being on the island over centuries and the current 20th century. And in a way, the island mirrors South Africa's history, because like you say, Katsapotelesi's four bears ended up on St. Helena, mm-hmm. and some of his other family ended up on Robben Island. So, but the most important is able to write a chapter on the coping skills of how people were able
to
on the island to form a community, mm-hmm. stepping off the island, mm-hmm. and then still the same life issues we face with us.
Let's look at it in this way. First of all, conditions were harsh when we first landed upon the island. These prison guards were vicious. They even got the criminals to turn against political offenders, telling them, "Look, these guys are communists. They are murderers. You don't trust them. You don't turn your back on them, because they will knife you," and so on. And the criminals actually believed these prison guards, and they turned on political offenders. But with time, these criminals realized, that the political prisoners were also fighting for them. Because the quality of a political prisoner was that they would not steal from you. Now, with the criminal mind, you put something down there, never mind what it is, it will disappear. And we showed them that we were of a different caliber. In fact, when political prisoners started standing, some of them were still kept with the hardened criminals in the same cells. These criminals then appealed to political prisoners for help with education. And they were very, very inspired by what the political element was doing. Some of, when we went on hunger strike in 1966, some of these criminals in the cells started joining the hunger strike. Some of them even joined political organizations. And that is what the authorities found as a threat to their security. And that's what all criminals were removed from amongst the political prisoners. Another thing was that for us as political offenders, it was so important to know what was happening in the world outside We will not allow newsmates. The criminals work in the homes of the prison guards. Where these prison guards, they were all white, would buy the burger, because they all wrote red Afrikaans. But these newspapers would be just abandoned. What we were allowed to buy then in those early days was a tube of toothpaste once a month, or a bar of soap once a month. We had an exchange program going with the criminals. We give you a tube of toothpaste, give us an old newspaper. We would hide that newspaper. And over time, that newspaper would be translated into English by one of the prisoners. And that was disseminated. That's how we got to know what was happening. I'll give you a story. Now, Christianity was the order on the island. Not Islam, not Hinduism, Christianity. So they allowed the Christian priests to come here freely on a Sunday. One of these priests that came was the Reverend September. And we used to see him come with his big, bulging case on a Sunday. And we realized that that guy is bringing the newspaper every Sunday. Before he comes to the island, he buys his newspaper. So it was decided that we are going to steal that newspaper. Now, political prisoners will not do anything that is bad, but steal a newspaper, they will. So we had this one guy, Yeni Ferris from Worcester. He's an ANC member. He had broken his banning order several times and they shoved him in jail. Now, he was Afrikaans speaking. So it was decided that Yeni would approach this priest and ask for permission to, if he could conduct the service. So Yeni then conducted the service on that day. Of course, we closed our eyes, and this was a hell of a long bloody play meeting. Kept watching to see what was happening. But eventually, of course, Yeni said, "Amen." But somebody, and that was Eddie Daniels, who's still alive today, who was given the duty to steal the newspaper. And once the newspaper had been hidden, Yeni said, "Amen." So we got to know what was happening in the world outside. And eventually the guys also got some of the prison guards to work with them. You see, when we were studying, these prison guards looked on us and they saw the progress that people had come to jail illiterate, the progress that they were making. Now these prison guards, some of them had been in the prison service for decades, could not be promoted, they did not have the necessary education. When they realized when they saw the progress that the illiterates were making, they said to themselves, if these guys can do it, we can also do it. So they started studying. Because if they could get better qualifications, it would mean that they could earn more money, get promotion, help their families. So they started studying. And they appealed to the political prisoners for help in their education. The unwritten code in jail was that when a prison guard asks for help, do not just hesitate to help him. By helping that prison guard and making a friend. So that also became a conduit for newspapers. And eventually they were even able to smuggle out codes to the families, via the prison guards. So these are all things that helped us. And of course, the intervention of the International Red Cross, Amnesty International, United Nations Organization, and people like Alan Susan. And all of this gave us hope, gave us strength, and our own sense, unity of purpose, that kept us strong. And learning to share and to care for each other, regardless of our political differences. Do I answer your question? Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. As a small token of our appreciation, I would like to give you It's a family history wine that's grown from all the different peoples in this world into our family history society.
Okay, good. So I don't get drunk.
I have to tell you, if you start getting your DNA done, if anybody has had their DNA done, I know Cherie has, I know one or two other people have, you will soon find out that you're not actually who you think you are. and for the lady who wanted to know, there is a platform in Cape Town called an archival platform that collects everybody's story. And I would, if you have a particular story, I would urge you to get onto the archival platform. They will assist you and they will publish it. Thank you very much for attending here. We've had a lovely afternoon. We've learned something that we didn't know before. And please have a join us for a cup of tea and lots of chat afterwards. Thank you very much. Bye.
Thank you.
With 3 days.